Here is another hydrocephalus, but now in breech presentation. The outline of the skull is very clearly seen. The skull bones are quite thin and suture lines are quite wide. With such a hydrocephalus, the thinness of the skull bones and the very wideness of the suture lines is quite evident in this radiograph. Another suture line which is quite widely open. Water density is because of the large volume of amniotic fluid around the baby, which itself is preterm and quite small as seen by the size of its head. Remaining part of the baby is not seen well, and presence of an open neural tube defect like spina bifida cannot be assessed from this radiogram. This is a case of an intrauterine fetal death. There is overlapping of the cranial bones, what is known as the Spalding sign, which is positive about a week after intrauterine fetal death. There is elevation of the subcutaneous fat line because of accumulation of edema fluid underneath the skull, which is known as the halo sign. The dark line is quite clearly seen in this portion. The fetal skull in this portion also shows the Spalding sign, overlapping of cranial bones. The remaining part of the skull is seen clearly. The baby's spine is in exaggerated flexion because of maceration of soft tissues, muscles and ligaments, which permit such flexion. This rolls the fetus into the form of a ball, which is known as a ball sign. Here is a case of intrauterine fetal death with chorioamnionitis due to gas producing organisms. The baby's head is seen in this area with severe overlapping of the cranial bones, what is known as a Spalding sign. The uterus is full of gas shadows. This gas is because of chorioamnionitis, and it is different from the gas which is found in fetal heart and major vessels or cerebral ventricles in cases of IFD. Here is a case of intrauterine fetal death in transverse line. The lateral view of the woman shows the baby's head with positive Spalding sign. The baby's spine is in extreme flexion, known as the ball sign. And there is some gas in the fetal heart. This is a mixture of carbon dioxide, oxygen and nitrogen liberated from blood, and it is not a product of bacterial infection. intrauterine fetal death which delivered the head showing spalding sign and the neck while the trunk was not delivered. This is a case of trunk dystocia. Here is another case of intrauterine fetal death. In transverse lie, the baby's spine is crossing the maternal spine and it's extremely flexed, the ball sign. Here is another case of intrauterine fetal death in cephalic presentation showing the spalding sign and the ball sign. It's a plain radiograph of the abdomen and pelvis of a pregnant woman, which can be used for X-ray pelvimetry. The woman has been in labor, as is evident by the molding of the fetal skull, which is seen here. The fetus appears normal. For assessment of the pelvis, one has to look at the shape of the pelvic inlet, which can be assessed to a certain extent even on anteroposterior plate. In modern obstetrics, one does not take an inlet view because it causes unnecessary irradiation of the fetal gonads. The widest transverse diameter of the inlet should be measured. It can be called X-ray pelvimetry in examinations if it has been marked out by a line like that. And its comparison to the size of the baby's head should also be done at this stage. The lateral pelvic walls in adequate and normal pelvis of gynecoid anthropoid type should be parallel to each other, as they are in this case. The plane of the least pelvic dimensions is at the level of the ischial spines, which are not prominent in this case, and in an X-ray pelvimetry that diameter also would be marked by a line like that. The subpubic angle can be reasonably accurately assessed on an anteroposterior plate, though one would need an outlet view for that. Only for such information, one does not take an outlet view also in modern obstetrics. The only two views which are taken being anteroposterior view and lateral view. This is an adequate pelvis. This is a plain radiograph of the abdomen and pelvis of a pregnant woman, a lateral view. In this view, one can do pelvimetry also, and it can be called pelvimetry if the diameters are drawn out on the radiograph. One assesses the pelvis systematically from behind forwards. The maternal lumbar spine, the fifth lumbar vertebra is here. That is the sacral premonitory. The curvature of the front of the sacrum should be shallow. The sacrosciatic notches should be wide and shallow, as in this case. This is a reasonably well lateralized plate because the sacrosciatic notches seem to be overlapping each other reasonably well. That is the outline of the ischial tuberosity. The two femoral heads are not very well overlapping. They should be in a well lateralized plate. And that is the pubic symphysis. The AP diameter of the inlet extends from the top of pubic symphysis to the sacral promontory, and it would be marked out like that in X-ray pelvimetry lateral view. The plane of minimum pelvic dimensions passes through the lower border of pubic symphysis and the ischial spine like that, and the AP diameter of the outlet passes like that. In X-ray pelvimetry lateral view, one also must assess the relationship between the widest transverse diameter of the baby's head and the pelvic inlet and say if the head is engaged or not. Also, one can assess the size of the baby's head and see if it will pass through those pelvic diameters. Here is a radiograph of a pregnant woman, abdomen and pelvis, which shows a funnel-shaped pelvis. The baby's head is well above the pelvic inlet. The lateral pelvic walls are convergent towards the outlet. The interosseal diameter is quite narrow, as marked out like this, and unlikely to permit the passage of the baby's head. The subpubic angle also appears to be quite narrow. Such a woman would require a caesarean section. A lateral radiograph of a pregnant woman showing the pelvis and the baby's head. The lumbar spine ends there. That is the sacral promontory. The front of the sacrum is extremely angulated. Such degree of curvature is likely to make the outlet narrow. Even the inlet of this woman's pelvis is small, as seen by the fact that the baby's head is still above the pelvic inlet and there is extreme molding of the baby's head due to pressure against the fifth lumbar vertebra and the sacral promontory well above the inlet. Presence of molding when the baby's head is above the inlet is a strong indication for a caesarean section. Here is radiograph of a pregnant woman, abdomen and pelvis, AP view. It shows the baby's head well above the pelvic inlet. However, the pelvis appears to be of adequate size and shape. The point of interest is in a scalp electrode which has been attached to the baby's skull, and the electrode wire is seen going out of the patient's pelvis and the vulva. This is an electrode used for intrapartum electronic fetal heart rate monitoring by recording the fetal ECG signal with an internal electrode. This woman was in labor and was being given a trial of labor, and in order to assess the well-being of the baby, a scalp electrode was attached. Here is an anteroposterior view of the abdomen and pelvis of a woman with severe kyphoscoliosis of the lumbar spine. The lateral curvature of the maternal spine is evident in that portion. One side femoral head is here. The other side femoral head is here. The oblique contraction of the pelvis is evident from the asymmetry of the two halves of the pelvis. The baby has assumed a position in which it is pushed towards one side of the maternal pelvis. Here is a lateral radiograph of the